My name is Lara Stein-Pardo. I'm a postdoc in the Laboratory for Race and Popular Culture and visiting assistant professor in the Department of Anthropology. Today we have a very special guest, Ruth Behar, and she's going to be talking about this concept and experience of being between two Cubas. I'm going to give a fuller introduction to Carol McGranahan, professor in the Department of Anthropology. And my role for today is mostly to thank all of you for coming out to participate both in the workshop this morning and in this talk tonight. And I also want to thank the people and the departments that made this event possible. The event is co-presented through the Laboratory for Race and Popular Culture, where I hold a postdoctoral fellowship, and Blackbird Arts and Research, a nonprofit organization that I founded in order to bring together art and research throughout academic and public spheres. And if you want to get on our mailing list, you can go to blackbirdarts.org, and that's where you might have found some information about the workshop and also the talk. Our sponsors are wide and varied, I think representing the interdisciplinary reach that Dr. Behar's work has had and continues to have. She works in multiple forms, and I think that the participation here today and also our sponsorship really shows that. So I want to thank the Graduate Committee on the Arts and Humanities, Anthropology, Film Studies, University Libraries, English, Latin American Study Center, Art and Art History, Geography, Sociology, Critical Media Practices, History, Writing and Rhetoric, Ethnic Studies, Jewish Studies, and Whole Foods catered the event. They contributed financially as well to the catering of the event. I also want to thank several people who really made this event possible. Ariel Milkman helped with the posters and distributing them, and I really appreciate that. Allison Hicks here at the library made it possible for us to be in this wonderful space. Carol McGranahan in the Department of Anthropology for talking through some of these ideas early on with me and for introducing Ruth today. Adam Bradley for bringing me into the University of Colorado as a postdoc in the RAP lab. And Alex Corey for being a compatriot in the RAP lab and for helping me get everything set up today. I really appreciate it. And most importantly, to Ruth Behar for joining us here today at CU Boulder. So now Carol McGranahan will introduce introduce Ruth Behar. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Lara. All right, so I am Carol McGranahan, Associate Professor of Anthropology here at CU, and it is my true pleasure to join Lara in welcoming you all to this very special event. We are really honored to have Ruth Behar here with us today for a series of events that actually began this morning with an ethnographic writing workshop and are now culminating with this talk right here, Between Two Cubas, Notes of a Native Daughter. So Ruth Behar is the Victor Haim Perera Collegiate Professor of Anthropology at the University of Michigan. She received her PhD from Princeton University in 1983 for fieldwork conducted in Spain that resulted in her first book, The Presence of the Past in a Spanish Village, Santa Maria del Monte, and that was in 1986. She next turned her anthropological research to Mexico and to a book that changed the ethnographic possibilities for writing in ways that we're still working through today. And I refer, of course, to Translated Woman, Crossing the Border with Esperanza's Story, which came out in 1993. Since then, her writing has continued to engage and challenge, and perhaps both delight and frustrate, anthropologists, other scholars, and other readers in thinking out loud the boundaries of writing, of storytelling, and of a commitment to histories big and small as lived by real people. Ruth's other and many books, and this is a long list, are in 1995, Women Writing Culture, which she edited with Deborah Gordon, 1995 again, Bridges to Cuba, in 1996, The Vulnerable Observer, Anthropology That Breaks Your Heart, and I note that Ruth insists that anthropology that breaks your heart is the only kind worth doing. 2007, An Island Called Home, Returning to Jewish Cuba. 2008, The Portable Island, Cubans at Home and in the World, edited with Lucia Suarez. And in 2013, Traveling Heavy, A Memoir in Between Journeys. In addition, Ruth has written articles almost too numerous to count, has made an ethnographic film, Adio Querida, Goodbye, Dear Love, and most recently has embarked on two new projects. The first is writing her own poetry and also collaborating with the poet Richard Blanco in creating the website www.bridgestocuba.com. And the second is a project I just heard about for the first time this morning, a novel for young readers called Lucky Broken Girl, which I cannot wait to read with my own daughter. Ruth's scholarship has been acknowledged by communities around the world, from a MacArthur Genius Grant to letters and emails from students who write to tell her that they saw themselves or saw their families, saw their hopes and their dreams in her writing. In preparing to introduce Ruth, I indulged myself last night in reading everything I had from her on my shelves, on my laptop in PDF form, and even in old-fashioned paper files and photocopies. I teach Ruth's work often, I read it even more, and yet rereading it in one fell swoop as I did last night was beyond inspiring. Her anthropology is the kind to which I aspire. What is it, you might ask, as her Aunt Rebecca once asked her? It's not just the study of people and their customs. Yes and no. Yes, and yet it is so much more than that. And Ruth's answer to her aunt was this: anthropology is the most fascinating, bizarre, disturbing, and necessary form of witnessing left to us at the end of the 20th century. And although she wrote this in 1996, I think those words still hold true for us now in the opening decades of the 21st century. I want to call out the work of four anthropologists here at CU who I think prove Ruth's kind of view of anthropology to be true. One is my colleague Kaifa Roland, whose research on Cuba, on her own body being read and responded to during her research, on an embodied ethnography that is also deeply theoretical and deeply thoughtful, and on La Lucha, on the struggle that continues, reminds me of Ruth's work. On my colleague Donna Goldstein, somewhere here in the room, writing in Brazil about Gloria, who I think of as someone who might be friends with Esperanza, about race and sexuality and gender and violence, and about laughter out of place. Writing an anthropology that had a person, a real person who we come to know and even love and remember at its center, and written by an anthropologist who we also come to know and come to trust and respect. My colleague in ethnic studies, Bianca Williams, who writes between Jamaica and the United States, writing about black women's happiness, writing race into the affect literature, writing about racism, about black lives that matter, and writing her truth and insisting on it with her own fierce and passionate brand of radical honesty. And Lara, where has she gone? Lara Stein Parda, working on Cuban, Caribbean, and Latin American diasporas in Miami, a student of Ruth's, and then working on visual arts as cutting through archived and sedimented stereotypes, as challenging colonial past reinscribed into presence, and on thinking about art as work. All of us, and I include myself, regardless of our relationship to Ruth's work or even to Ruth herself, have had the possibilities for our writing and for our thinking of anthropology transformed by Ruth's writing. And yet it's Ruth's reflexive writing that people remember. The sensational, sometimes even the scandalous. The worries about emotional hemophilia on behalf of those we write about. What we forget are her deep genealogies, her tributes to those writers and scholars who came before. There was a moment in the 1990s when she and many other anthropologists thought that an attentive to writing was going to be run out of the discipline. That a scientific way of writing would win. That we would lose the beauty of language in favor of the utility of it. They were wrong, and I'm so right. I'm so happy they were wrong. And I think given that it is Ruth, and none other than Ruth who I'm introducing, I must explain this with a story. A story that is mine to tell, but one that I have never written about or even talked about, and not even with my students who I tell things I never anticipated I would tell. And yet it's a story I think about all the time. I will make it short. I'll try. I started graduate school in 1993 at the University of Michigan, where Ruth taught. This was the same year that Translated Woman came out. The Woman Writing Culture Project was already well underway, and the two male professors of our required introductory theory class taught Zora Neale Hurston alongside Malinowski and Evans Pritchard and Levi Strauss. How progressive they were, I thought. And yet, who was their colleague? Ruth. And so right here in this moment, I want to acknowledge Ruth's role in shifting the anthropological canon. When I teach this same class here at CU, and today Ruth actually came to visit with this class and talk with our students, we read Hurston, and we also read other scholars who Ruth introduced me to, such as Ella DeLoria, and we read her fiction, and we read her policy writing, along with her ethnography. However, this isn't the story I wanted to tell you. This is that story. Before I started graduate school, I was out at a bar with a group of friends. and I overheard my then boyfriend and a female friend, who were both aspiring novelists, talking about writing. We'll call them Brian and Susan, because those are their names. Susan said to Brian, and this is, you know, midway through their conversation, Carol is a writer too. And he said, Carol's not a writer, she's an anthropologist. I got to Michigan, and those words haunted me, Carol is not a writer. I tell this story now to explain to Ruth 23 years later why I never took your seminar in ethnographic writing. And it's my one real regret from grad school. But how I got the syllabus anyway. And I read everything on it. And I talked with my friends who were in the class about writing. And how just being in that space she created, Ruth created, where anthropology was writing, where writing was about craft, had a deep impact on me. And how I now seek out and create conversations about writing with my students and with my colleagues. And I just want to publicly acknowledge how large my debt is to you for this. So thank you, Ruth, and welcome. God, why do I do this every time? We are truly honored to have you here with me. And so now, without further ado, everyone, please join me in welcoming Ruth Behar.
Thank you. Oh my gosh. Well, that's an introduction. Yeah, I'm kind of in tears myself too. So. Thank you. So there's anthropology that breaks your heart and there's anthropology that heals your heart. So thank you for that today. That was beautiful. And thank you for sharing that story and such a beautiful introduction. I would rather just listen to you this afternoon, but I'm going to try to give this talk about Cuba. Thank you so much, Carol. And thank you so much, Lara Steinpardo, for organizing my visit and bringing me here. I've loved being in Boulder. I've felt at home since I got here yesterday. It's very similar to Michigan. We just don't have all the sunshine you have, but you know, if I could just bottle some of it and take it to Ann Arbor, it would be great. But Lara, I'm so proud of all the work that you've been doing, bringing together scholarship and the arts, and so glad to be here today, and so honored by all the sponsors that have supported my visit. And I tried to create a talk where hopefully I can speak to many, many disciplines and speak in many different voices about Cuba. So I do have a paper, and I'll try reading it. If it starts to be too formal, I might just throw it away and just start talking. So let's see. Okay. So there are small places that loom large in the world. Cuba is one of those places. I've got a. Okay, perfect. Okay. As Alma Guillermo Prieto put it, such a small island, such a great role in history. Relative to its population of 11 million, Cuba played an outsized role in the history of the 20th century and continues to do so now in our emerging 21st century. On December 17th, 2014, a day Cubans associate with San Lázaro Babaluaye, the deity who heals the sick and infirm, the governments of the U.S. and Cuba agreed to restore ties after close to 60 years of a Cold War freeze. Ever since, Cuba has been in the American media on an almost daily basis. Only a few decades ago, Cuba was only the obsession of Cubans who had left the island. The main American news source on Cuba was El Nuevo Herald, the Spanish version of the Miami Herald. These days, you can find coverage of Cuba in the New York Times, and one of the latest articles is about how you need to make reservations now if you want to dine in Havana's best private restaurants. Also, the Associated Press, CNN, and a multitude of other media are maintaining permanent reporters on the ground in Cuba now. And President Obama's visit to Cuba during the March spring break has heightened this Cuba mania. I think I've got a couple of slides here, including this somewhat funny one that was circulating in Cuba before Obama's visit. I hope that, you know, financially things are going to get a little better, even if it involves putting him on the 100 peso bill. I think I've got one other one, So all eyes are fixed on the island. It's a tsunami, a friend told me. He heads up an art foundation in Havana that can't keep up with all the American groups who want to stop by for a visit. Everyone is coming here, he says, everyone. There are places that belong to their native sons and daughters. Cuba has become a place that belongs to the entire world. There are two questions I hope to try to answer in this talk today. How did all this come to be? And how do I feel about it as a native daughter? To answer the first question, we have to address at least some of the history. And forgive me if this is all stuff you know, and I know some of you here are taking Cuba classes. So, as everyone knows, Cuba carried out a lasting communist revolution in the backyard of the United States, the most powerful capitalist country in the world. This revolution, led by charismatic leaders Fidel Castro and the Argentinian Che Guevara, was carried out in a Caribbean island whose historical legacy was, quote, a counterpoint of tobacco and sugar, as anthropologist Fernando Ortiz put it. The social, economic, and racial bedrock of Cuba was founded on the destruction of the Native American population, often symbolized by the heroic struggle of the Taino chieftain Atue, who was burned at the stake by Spanish colonizers, only to become a brand of Cuban beer. I hope I have him here. And the plantation system, I'll see if it's in the next slide, and the plantation system fueled by the labor of enslaved West Africans. I forgot that slide of the Cuban beer. But anyway, the city of Havana, with its grand harbor and port, became the crossroads for ships moving gold and silver from the mines of Mexico and Peru to Spain. A walled and fortified city, everyone desired Havana. The British briefly snatched it from the Spaniards. It was a city through which people, goods, and ideas flowed in and out, making it a sophisticated metropolis in the Americas. Now again today, everyone wants a piece of Havana. Everyone is smitten by Havana's cool vibe, from Obama to the Rolling Stones to Chanel, which will be treating the Malecón Seafront Promenade as a fashion runway this coming May. And I brought this bag. Some of you may have seen this. Actually, I'm in Havana, and I'll talk a little bit more about this a little later, but this is by a new designer in Havana. So the coolness of Havana. So the United States had a romance with the island that began long before the involvement in Cuba's independence struggles at the end of the 19th century. As early as 1821, Thomas Jefferson spoke of the American desire to possess Cuba, declaring, "I have ever looked on Cuba as the most interesting addition which could ever be made to our system of states." Although territorial dreams were held in check, except of course for the base of Guantanamo, the U.S. sought to develop Cuba in its own image. The Hotel Havana Libre, where Fidel Castro set up his first office, was briefly the Havana Hilton. Cadillacs and Buicks and Chevys were tested on the Malecón before they raced down Route 66, and that's why so many remain today in Cuba. By the 1950s, Cuba had become a society built on gambling, prostitution, and tourism, financed by American capital. The circle of relations between Cuba and the U.S. was extensive. Wealthy Cubans hopped over to Miami for a weekend to go shopping, while numerous Americans went on weekend trips to Cuba to enjoy cabarets and beaches. A special flight allowed Americans to get a taste of the Tropicana nightclub right on board the plane. And the ferry allowed Americans to bring their cars to Cuba, and now there's four ferry companies that have been approved by the U.S. government to go to Cuba, but we're still waiting for approval from Cuba. And you probably know this, the most famous drink of the era was a Cuba Libre, or a free Cuba, and it was a combination of Cuban rum and American Coca-Cola. Even in the heady days of the revolution, you could find a supply of Coca-Cola at the birthday party of Che Guevara's first son, Camilo. I Love Lucy epitomized the romance between Cuba and the U.S. By loving Lucy, Desi loved the United States. These two actors enacted a romance that was an apt metaphor for the political relationship between the two nations. Their painful real-life divorce seemed to foretell the end of the bond between the U.S. and the island that had seemed charming as long as it was Ricky Ricardo and his bongo drums, until the island dared to question American hegemony. Many Cubans came to resent their role in a Pygmalion script, and so they bit the hand that fed them and carried out a revolution in 1959, which tore apart the marriage between the U.S. and Cuba. Castro and the rebels expropriated large properties that had been in private hands, mostly American, from oil to sugar plantations to hotels. They nationalized the banks. They went on to expropriate smaller properties, stores, and even peddling operations run by Cubans. They supported a literacy campaign that sent well-off white students from Havana to the countryside to teach poor white and black people in the countryside how to read, implementing an educational program for all that was revolutionary and that would do away with private and religious parochial schools. When they decided to let the Soviets refine their oil, the U.S. retaliated, imposing a trade embargo upon Cuba in 1961, and on the island it came to be called a blockade, a much stronger term. Diplomatic ties between the U.S. and Cuba were severed. The Bay of Pigs invasion followed, and when the CIA-trained Cuban-American forces failed to bring down Castro and the rebels, there was no turning back from the divorce. The Cold War effectively put Cuba on a different map, a Soviet map, and Cuba was removed from maps of Florida and cruise maps of the Caribbean. It was as if Cuba was exiled from the United States, and the 90 miles separating the island from the shores of Florida became some of the longest 90 miles in history. I also have this wonderful picture from the day that Fidel Castro marched into Havana. So the fascination that Americans today have with the island has everything to do with the fact that Cuba managed to exist for half a century without the United States being there. Cuba is a kind of fantasy preserved in amber, an enchanted place where time supposedly stood still after the U.S. went away. And though for a time Cuba seemed like a dangerous communist island, it now represents to many Americans a welcome departure from what they consider the worst aspects of American culture, a place that sacrificed material goods for an ideal of revolution. Those who have already visited Cuba feel fortunate to have gone before, and these are Americans themselves, before all the ugly Americans swarmed the gates. A neighbor in Ann Arbor put it this way: "What's so compelling about going to Cuba is to be away from the things I don't like about the U.S. You could go to Bali or Thailand and still see a McDonald's on the corner. Visually, there's something so gratifying not seeing anything that represents the commercialization of our world. That the U.S. is not there is a huge relief. Rather than feeling triumphant about the spread of capitalism, my neighbor is concerned about the destructive influence that American capitalist values might have in Cuba. There's already a kind of anticipation of nostalgia that the authenticity and charm of Cuba will vanish and Americans will no longer have such a poignant and nearby destination to express disaffection with their own culture." And of course, Cuban Americans perceive Cuba very differently. Immigration was woven early on into the conflict between Cuba and the U.S. starting in the 60s, and the Cubans who opposed the new revolutionary regime chose exodus, chose to leave the island, and the U.S. in turn opened its doors wide to these refugees fleeing communism. And in particular, as you probably know, the U.S. gave Cubans the special privilege given to no other Latino immigrants of being able to ask for asylum upon setting foot on American soil, and after a year and a day to streamline their application for U.S. citizenship. This picture, in fact, is of my grandmother leaving Cuba. So while fleeing Cubans were accepted into the U.S., achieving symbolic capital as opponents of communism, in Cuba, they, or we, were viewed as traitors. Those who left Cuba were called gusanos, or worms. We were viewed as subhuman, perceived as having turned our backs on the ideal of bringing equality and social justice to the nation. Leaving was an act of betrayal against the nation, a form of treason against the revolution. You could only take one suitcase, and homes and possessions had to be left behind. An inventory was taken on the day of departure to make sure. It was common practice to place a sign on those homes that were left behind that read, "Esta es tu casa, Fidel." This is your house, Fidel. And passports were stamped, "Salida definitiva," literally definitive departure or no return. So many Cuban families split apart at that time because of ideological differences. Brothers broke with brothers, sisters broke with sisters, parents broke with their children, children broke with their parents. There was no middle ground at that time. You either supported Castro and the revolution or you opposed it and chose exile. And departures from Cuba at that time were very wrenching. Jose Figueroa, the photographer who took this picture, captured the intensity of one of those goodbyes, both personal and historic, in an epic photograph that he called Exilio. And he took the picture literally as he was waving goodbye to his own mother as she left Cuba. He couldn't leave because he was of military age and not allowed to leave. The Cuban government wouldn't allow him to leave. And he also, at the time, made a series of family photographs that shown together reflect how the family in Cuba grew smaller and smaller as more relatives left. In a later picture, Figueroa is shown only with his brother, who also stayed. And interestingly, Figueroa was an apprentice to Alberto Korda, who took the famous photograph that you all know of Che Guevara. And as an apprentice, he was given the task often of making copies of this iconic picture for Korda, and that's how he became a documentary photographer. So for many of us who were taken out of Cuba as children, as I was 4 and a half when we left, the word gusano, the word worm, was a real source of shame. Our parents weren't ashamed. They proudly called themselves the historic exiles. Later, other Cubans left in other mass exoduses and the Mariel boat lift in 1980 and many on rafts in 1994. Some more pictures here. And people have been leaving quietly in the last 20 years, overstaying visas and defecting. In the past year, you've probably read in the news since the restoration of ties, a rush of Cuban immigrants have left via Ecuador and Costa Rica, then crossing at the Mexican border, worried that they will lose their special status as Cuba and the U.S. continue to move to normalize relations. And many want to gain U.S. residency and then be able to travel back and forth to Cuba. So these historic exiles that I mentioned earlier, people like my parents, they remain unique in that they established the idea of the island outside the island, the mirror island in the U.S., viewing themselves as people who would not return to Cuba until the political system changed and Castro was no longer in power. Now it's the Castros in the plural. While waiting for the revolutionary system to implode, to fall from its own weight, as they said, so they could go back and reclaim their old lives in Cuba, they remembered Cuba daily, maintaining the Spanish language, preserving their memories, continuing to cook Cuban food, and recreating as much of the island as they could in another place, in the enclaves they built in Miami and New Jersey and elsewhere, often opening up restaurants and stores that had the same names and sometimes the same owners that they had had in Cuba. So here, La Moderna Poesia, which has shut down in Miami, a bookstore, and that's named after the original Moderna Poesia in Havana. And here's Rincón Criollo, the restaurant that I grew up eating at in New York on Junction Boulevard and Roosevelt Avenue, if anybody is ever there. It's still there, Rincón Criollo. And it's the only restaurant that has pictures of me and my family on the walls of the restaurants. So anyway, so they cultivated their nostalgia And through the nostalgia for the pre-revolutionary Cuba of their memories, they created an imaginary homeland. And Richard Blanco, the poet, has this wonderful line, perhaps the only true home is the one that we lose. And interestingly, and I always think about this, it was that nostalgia that sparked curiosity among so many of us children of exiles, and that's what made so many of us want to go to Cuba and see with our own eyes this place that our families were endlessly recreating in their stories. So the exiles chose not to return. My parents have never been back, even though I've been back probably 100 times or something. They chose not to return, but they also refused to forget the island. And I think about this, if they had simply let go of Cuba, we in the second generation might have moved on, but didn't. And so they kept looking back, and it was this unwavering need to remember that conjured the island for so many of us. So there was this, of course, tremendous antagonism between the U.S. and Cuba throughout the 60s and into the end of the 70s. So it was literally impossible to go to Cuba in those two decades. And that situation changes in 1977 while Jimmy Carter is president. The U.S. and Cuba establish limited diplomatic relations. And that's when they open these interest sections in Washington and Havana, not exactly embassies, but sections housed within the Swiss embassy. And then in 1978, Fidel Castro meets with representatives of the Cuban community in exile, engaging in what comes to be known as el diálogo. And that's the moment in which Cuba begins to open its doors to what was called the Family Reunification Program, recognizing the right of Cubans in the U.S. to return to Cuba to visit their homeland. So even though our passports had been stamped, salida definitiva, still, there is a sense of, wait a minute, there's still a right to go back and visit family. So this was the time of the civil rights movement, the protests against the war in Vietnam, the Chicano movement, the feminist movement, and Cuban Americans who came of age in this era, as I did, formed part of a radical generation that was pushing for reconciliation with Cuba. The Antonio Maceo Brigade was formed in a group of young, idealistic Cuban American writers and intellectuals, most of them white, most of them children of the historic exiles, traveled together to Cuba and produced a testimonial book and manifesto called Contra Viento y Marea, Against Wind and Tide. And very interestingly, the motto was, not all Cubans are gusanos, okay? Not all Cubans are worms. So these children of the exiles, here's the book cover, wanted to support Cuba, wanted to support the revolution and communist ideals, even while having been raised in capitalist American society. And they spoke directly to Fidel Castro and asked him to let them return to live on the island, but he responded that they could do more for Cuba, serving as advocates for the revolution in the United States. And a very important figure at that time, Lourdes Casal, who was a psychologist, a sociologist, and a poet, a woman of Black Chinese heritage and middle-class background. She was initially an opponent of Fidel Castro and his regime, but then she became an active supporter of the Cuban Revolution and was one of the first Cuban Americans to go back to the island. And she became a leader of the Antonio Maceo Brigade and spent extended periods in Cuba in the 70s up until 1981, when unfortunately she died young. And she wrote a major poem that defined the way many Cubans of the radicalized generation felt, being in between two homes, tu habanera, to be New Yorkina, tu New Yorkina, to be, even to become again, anything else. So when I first went back in 1979, I was a graduate student. My head was in the clouds. I didn't know about Lourdes Casal. I was part of a delegation of students and professors from Princeton. And I remember listening to many speeches and not being allowed to move around on our own or even travel away from Havana without official government permission. And as a Cuban American, I was viewed as suspect and I was assigned a personal spy, but I was too young and too naive, so I thought he was just a nice Cuban guy who wanted to chat with me about the revolution. It turned out that, you know, he was informing on whatever bobadas, whatever silly things I was saying at that time when I was 20 years old. And so I'd hoped to get permission to do my dissertation research in Cuba, but the door closed in 1980 with the Mariel exodus, and then I went on to do my research in Spain and in Mexico, and then began to go back again in 1991 when I decided decided I had to normalize my relation with my native land, even if the two countries that define my identity were maintaining an abnormal relation. So I started traveling to Cuba 2 and 3 times a year. Being Cuban-born and the child of exiles, the decision to return and to reclaim the island required a certain fortitude. It meant turning my back on my family, trying not to feel that I was acting monstrously and choosing to keep revisiting the place that they had left to give me a, quote, better life in the United States. I carried the weight of inherited paranoia on every trip. They're going to tell you everything is perfect, but don't believe them, they're communists. Don't talk about politics. Be careful what you say. They're going to put you in jail. That was what I heard before every trip. And I have and developed a huge fear of Fidel Castro. All the exiles viewed him as personally responsible for our misery as immigrants. On 2 occasions, I had the chance to meet Fidel Castro and could have shaked his hand. And I ran in the opposite direction. I told myself I did so out of respect for my parents, but in truth, I was afraid that in his presence, I would turn to salt. And there was the fear that I would be in Cuba when he died. Carrying such guilt and fear, I found it difficult to enjoy Cuba. In any case, I thought it almost morally wrong to enjoy Cuba. I was going to my native land for all those who wouldn't go because of political and ethical reasons and for deeper emotional reasons. They wanted to hold on to the Cuba of their memories, not see the other Cuba that had taken form in their absence. On those early trips to Cuba, I was terrified. I had anxiety attacks. I had heart palpitations. I was dizzy. I cried. I had nightmares. Ghosts seemed to be following me. I feared I'd faint or maybe I would disappear somewhere in Cuba, never be heard from again. Yet there were moments when I felt strangely safe, as if an angel were watching over me, and I would say to myself, nothing bad can happen here. This is where I was born. This is my home. Being born on the island, I'm still viewed as Cuban. In Cuba, you retain your nationality no matter what other citizenship you acquire. While it was possible for me to travel with my U.S. passport since I'd left before 1970, that's the rule they have in Cuba, each visit still required a visa from the Cuban immigration authorities, a very lengthy process. So I was told to apply for a Cuban passport, which required renewing the passport I had left the island with as a child. And that has become the passport with which I enter Cuba every time I go. I'm a Cuban national now when I set foot on the island, which means I'm subject to Cuban laws, a pretty scary prospect. They always check you more when they see you've got that other passport. Anyone not born in Cuba can enter the island with a simple tourist pass, but those of us born on the island are not allowed that status. We are blessed and cursed to be Cubans forever. And it's very interesting, I don't know how many of you have heard the Carnival Cruise Line, and I'm not somebody that has really ever gone on cruises, but it's very upsetting. They have announced that supposedly they're going to start cruises from Miami to Havana now in May, but they have this rule that if you are a Cuban-born Cuban-American, you cannot go on the cruise. Now, is that discrimination? Right, so there's, and apparently it's a rule that has been pushed upon Carnival by the Cuban government that is always suspicious of Cuban-born Cubans. So all Cuban-born Cubans who travel to the island go through an intense security check. They don't let every Cuban-born Cuban-American return to the island. So, and then on the American side, I've been able to travel easily to Cuba for the last 25 years as a researcher and professor who works on Cuba. And anthropology, I always say this, has been my passport. As an anthropologist, I have to go to the places that I study. I can't just read about Cuba from a distance. Fieldwork, immersion, participation, those are our methods, and I have to steep myself in Cuban reality as it is, to delve deep into the substratum of Cuban culture and emotion and try not to get entangled in the polarized politics of Cuba. A tightrope that all of us walk who do work in Cuba, a tightrope that I think Obama himself has had to walk, seeking social and economic change on the island while respectfully meeting with Raul Castro and not bad-mouthing the revolution. My return to Cuba at first was about wanting to stand in the places where I stood as a child, to reclaim those places spiritually. We had lived next door to the Patronato, the Jewish Community Center. I'd been photographed there as a child. And I wanted to, as I said, stand in those very places at first. I had not been interested in studying Jews when I did research in Spain and Mexico, and in fact had often hidden my Jewish identity, feeling it would separate me from people. But in Cuba, I didn't want to hide anything about myself. Even then, it was only after many back and forth trips that I began to seriously observe the tiny remaining Jewish community of 1,000 people traveling all over the island, looking for encounters with Jews and trying to find a way to write about them that neither hurt them nor me, creating a chronicle of these encounters, many of which were eerie and gave me a feeling of being among people shipwrecked and holding on to evidence of a Jewish past in documents and old photographs. And also, I don't have time to go into this, but you know, studying anthropology and reading about the Kung of the Kalahari Desert, like people who are constantly being studied and observed, I never thought I would experience that myself in Cuba, and the Jewish community on the island has become such a community that's constantly being observed by outsiders. So relative to the size of the community, which is about 1,000 people, there are always people coming through and observing this community. On one of the early trips, I went looking for the tombstone of my mother's cousin, Henry, who you see here, who died of leukemia in Cuba as a boy of 12 before my family left Cuba. My great uncle and great aunt had felt sorrow at leaving their son behind in his grave and feared that nothing remained of him in the old Jewish cemetery. They thought the tombstone and so on would have been destroyed. And I learned and found the tombstone. I learned that Caro, you see here, who had been my nanny, and her older sister, Tere, who had been Henry's and his sister Alma's nanny, they had continued to visit the grave of my cousin after our family left. And Caro held on to all these photographs of our family. Here she's got a photograph of my great grandparents. And she mixed those photographs with the photographs of her own family in the same shoebox. And so I discovered that an Afro-Cuban woman who wasn't Jewish had preserved my heritage in Cuba. She had carried on another kind of remembering on the island parallel to that of exiles like my parents. And this experience of re-encountering Caro, a very important figure from my childhood, was so strong that I came back to writing poetry, even though I had given up poetry when I went into anthropology. And one of those first poems that I wrote was about being back in Cuba, and it was about finding the Jewish cemetery of Guanabacoa, which told the story of my cousin's tombstone and how he got left behind and how Tere had continued to visit him. Okay, a poem, by the way, that my family did not like very much at all. And Caro would go with me to the airport every time I would depart again, reenacting the scene of departure from my childhood, which was far from innocent, enmeshed in racial and class distinctions that allowed us to leave while she stayed behind. And I feared we were characters in what I called an untellable story, the white bourgeois girl coming back to Cuba, seeking a sentimental bond with the black working class woman who'd been her nanny in an era of social inequality. But I hoped as well that we could surpass those roles from the past and find a way to build a different relationship in the present. Caro has brought me into her family, given me a family in Cuba, while I in turn have helped her children and grandchildren with things that they have needed from the United States. Caro has brought me into her family, into cooking, one of the things that was very, very moving, that returned me to a kind of primordial past, was tasting her malanga fritters. And malanga, this root vegetable, it's hardier than a potato, and it's the first solid food given to babies in Cuba. So somehow that malanga sort of brought me back to something in my childhood. And she told stories about my family that no one else told me, so she really became an anchor and offered me a kind of homecoming that I was really searching for. And then I received another homecoming from our former neighbors who live in the building where I lived as a small child. And you see Consuelo and Edilberto, the elders here now in their mid-80s, and a white middle-class couple who were friends of my parents, and they continue to live down the hall from the apartment that we occupied, in the same apartment that they lived in during the 1950s. And Edilberto, a teacher, he was a fervent believer in the revolution, and that's why they chose to stay. And when we left, my parents were careful to tell him we were just going on a vacation, not immigrating, so he wouldn't report us. And my father to this day has not totally let go of his anger against Edilberto. But he and Consuelito, together with their daughter, Cristi, who you see here, just a few years younger than me, and in many ways my exact counterpart, they have been as gracious to me as Caro and her family. And when Cristi married Pepe, an engineer, they came to live in the apartment with the family. And their daughter, Monica, who's not here now in her early 30s, lives there as well, as is typical in Havana, where housing is in short supply and 3 and 4 generations live together. And now, I wasn't going to talk about this, but I'll just mention it. I'm going through something that is going to be a very interesting process. Cuba is now allowing those of us who left and were born in Cuba to repatriate to Cuba, and I already have my Cuban passport, and now there's one more step that I could take where I would repatriate and become, in a sense, a Cuban national again, even get a ration card and an ID card. And in order to do that, you have to have people in Cuba that vouch for you and that would take care of you and house you in their home while you find your own home in Cuba. And the people who have agreed to do that and actually volunteered to do that are Consuelito and Edilberto. So they're the ones that have recently filled out this paperwork. And if it all moves forward, I will repatriate. I will not lose my US citizenship, but I will also be fully Cuban. So we'll see how that process goes. And being with Cristi, and I'll try to talk a little quickly because I know we're running out of time, I get a sense of who I might have been had we stayed in Cuba. I see her frustration. She studied information sciences and had hoped for a certain kind of social standing that she didn't get. And she's become a private entrepreneur, renting out to foreigners a casa particular, an apartment in the same building where I lived as a child, that she inherited from two aunts who never married. And not one to mince words, Cristi says, thanks to that apartment, we eat. And the apartment is equipped with air conditioning and a hot shower at all hours, comforts that the apartment in which they live doesn't have. And every night she has internet access through an acquaintance who's married to a Spaniard, and she allows her to use her connection for a set number of hours. It's very expensive, even though it's a dial-up connection, and pathetically slow. And so I see her desperation as she tries to respond to clients who want to make a reservation to stay in her apartment, and then the connection is suddenly lost. Her desktop computer is in the bedroom she shares with Pepe, only a few feet away from her parents' bedroom, where Monica also sleeps. I wonder what it would be like to live this close to my parents and not have any privacy. Would I have been able to manage? I know that Cristi sees herself in me as well, though she is prone to embarrassing me, saying things like, your parents saved you, Ruthie, so be happy. You were lucky. They took you out of here. My parents kept me here to suffer. And only last year were she and Pepe able to travel for the first time outside of Cuba. And of course, they went to Miami. They're doing well enough that they were able to save just enough money from their rental apartment to buy 2 plane tickets to Miami. And they stayed with Cristi's cousins, who covered their expenses. So I'm going to move forward a bit, and all these changes that are taking place in Cuba now are changes that began in the 1990s when Cuba opened up to tourism. They opened up also to Cuban Americans who were starting to return. And this is the moment when Americans start going to Cuba, the end of the Soviet period. National Geographic runs this article on Cuba. And we all know that when National Geographic runs an article on a country, it means that it's safe for Americans to go there. So that was the beginning. And the article came out in 1999, the Buena Vista Social Club came next and reminded Americans of the beautiful music that came from Cuba. And I love this piece also by that same artist who did the other can. And do you all know what that says in Russian? Anybody? Perestroika. So this is kind of his idea of the Cuban version of Perestroika. You have the Matryoshka dolls, and then in the center, there's the bottle of Coca-Cola again that we talked about at the beginning of this presentation. So now, cigar smoking has become fashionable, mojitos, every corner of the country, Americans are finding reasons to go to Cuba. And I'm going to show you some pictures, and people are searching for this interesting combination of 1950s Cuba and revolutionary Cuba at the same time. And haven't read this article by Florence Babb, it's wonderful, Che, Chevy's, and Hemingway's daiquiris, and she points out that there's this interesting way in which it seems contradictory, but people are looking for this these two moments to converge, the 1950s on the one hand and the revolution on the other, and nostalgia for both. And also I mentioned the concern or the interest in the Jews of Cuba, many, many travelers going to see the community, and even in Ann Arbor, there has been a Cuba craze. And so those first trips in the 90s, that was when I met writers and intellectuals. There was very little information at the time about literature, scholarship, and art being created on the island starting in the early 90s. And I found that there were many creative thinkers who wanted to connect with those of us who had left. And we found that we had lots of things in common. We'd grown up in different places, some on the island, some outside the island, but there was a lot of culture and memory that we shared. But I was also aware that that I had the privilege, being the child of exiles, to be able to go back and forth, but my counterparts in Cuba at that time in the 90s did not have that same ability to go back and forth. And one of the pieces in the book Bridges to Cuba by Jorge Luis Arcos had this idea, diaspora, like death, interrupts the conversation, right? So it seemed like once somebody left, you wouldn't connect with them anymore. This is, again, in the era before the internet, and so much has changed with the internet. And I want to mention a very dear friend, Rolando Esteves, who has a very sad story that fortunately he's been able to transmogrify in his art. And he was taken to a movie theater while his mother packed her bags in 1969, preparing to leave with her husband and 8-year-old daughter. And Esteves, again, like Figueroa earlier, was 15 and of military age, and so he couldn't leave Cuba. And his parents left him behind, assuming he would come later. But the decision was so painful for him that he afterwards didn't want to leave, and his mother had a nervous breakdown. So these kinds of stories that are so powerful among Cubans, and he wrote this lovely poem, and also he's a book artist and made this incredible book. And now, over the past 20 years, we've collaborated together on many, many handmade books, and I've been able to invite him to the University of Michigan, and he's invited me in turn to Matanzas to present my work, so we've become bridges for each other between the two Cubas. The meaning of the bridge is very, very different. Today, since Raul Castro took power in 2008, the Cuban government has made it easier for Cubans to travel back and forth, and now, very interestingly, people can be out of the country for up to 2 years without losing their homes, their possessions, and their ration cards. And all you need to do is return for a few days just before that 2-year period, and then you can be gone again for another 2 years without penalty. So many Cubans are doing that, and this is, of course, an enormous change from that era when my my parents left where you were a worm and your passport was stamped salida definitiva and so on. And many of the new restaurants and private businesses that you're hearing about in Cuba are owned and run by these Cubans who have spent a few years abroad, often in Europe, gaining work experience and saving up to buy property in Cuba, since it's now also possible to buy and sell property, which was forbidden in the past. So what does the idea of a bridge to Cuba mean at this moment when Cubans are more mobile, Americans are rushing to get to the island before it loses its charm, supposedly? And so I've joined forces, as was said earlier by Carol, with Cuban-American poet Richard Blanco, who I mentioned earlier, and he was chosen by Obama to be the inaugural poet during his second inauguration ceremony. We've created this blog, Bridges to From Cuba, before it was just Bridges to and now To and From Cuba, lifting the emotional embargo, which is a fascinating concept of Richard's, and this idea that important personal stories of Cubans are being lost in this rush that everybody has to get to Cuba. So a couple of more slides here to just show you kind of how Cuba looks now. This is the money signs on the bicycle taxi and kids wearing Nike t-shirts, the relationship between the young Fidel at the time, but now the old Fidel, and the forever young Che. Featured on Newsweek here, Viva el Capitalismo, and Che still guarding over the ham sandwiches, and this very interesting picture, Paris Hilton with Fidelito, Fidel Castro's oldest son, taking a selfie. So you know, the granddaughter of the owner of the Habana Libre, which was originally a Hilton, now meeting with, you know, the son of Fidel Castro. So to some extent, the sense that some of the old hierarchies that were carefully hidden in the past are now being exposed. So I want to end, if I have a little bit more time, and just if you will indulge me with just two more stories that I was hoping to share and to answer a little bit more about how I feel about this moment and who do I want to be in the new Cuba. I've had a few experiences that have troubled me and left me uneasy in this past year as I've gone back and forth to Cuba. And one took place in a new gelato place in the new gentrifying Habana Vieja zone. It's a crossroads of tourists and galleries and boutiques and restaurants and local residents who don't have running water in their apartments. And El de Oro, it's a private business that only accepts the Cuban convertible currency. It offers gelato in flavors such as mojito and pineapple, and prices are less than you would pay in Europe or the U.S., but expensive for the average Cuban. And I was there one day with a Cuban artist friend who took me to see this place. We chose simple one-scoop cones, sat down on the slippery new plastic orange chairs. We started digging into our gelato. We saw two boys, aged 10 or 11, their faces pressed against the shiny glass window, staring at us, and they were Afro-Cuban, clearly kids from the neighborhood, a blonde German-speaking family with two children, the same age as the boys outside, sat down for gelatos, and when they saw that the boys were staring, they invited them inside and offered to buy them gelato. And an Afro-Cuban male employee scolded the boys for bothering the customers and ordered them to leave. Apparently, it was not the first time the boys had begged for ice cream. The couple purchased the gelato, brought it to the boys outside, and they stood eating it there until the employee told them to leave. And ice cream, some of you will know, is a political subject in Cuba. The state-run Copelia, here's some pictures, this was where the famous film Strawberry and Chocolate begins and ends. Some pictures, there's Copelia, the famous movie, Fresa y Chocolate, there. It was a socialist, or was created as a socialist ice cream cathedral soon after the revolution in 1966. It's an outdoor ice cream parlor surrounded by banyan trees and has the capacity to serve up to 35,000 people a day. And it was this utopian effort to bring ice cream to the people. And if you were willing to wait on a long line, and still, you could get very affordable ice cream in Cuban pesos. And I remember the early 1990s when milk was scarce and one meal a day was all that Cubans could hope for. People would line up at dawn at Copelia to buy ice cream for breakfast, and there were many flavors initially when the economy was subsidized by the Russians, but then when they hit the crisis in the 90s, it was reduced to offering only one quote-unquote feminine and one masculine flavor, the strawberry and the chocolate, thus the title of the movie. And here is the scene and another scene and another scene. It's a fascinating movie. I'm sure many of you have seen it, about a relationship between a straight guy and a gay guy and the friendship that they developed. So, and it's interesting that I found that on TripAdvisor, there were people raving about this gelato place and said it's all natural ice cream. And then somebody wrote, forget the very low standard Coppelia. And that was painful. And although the gelato was delicious, made with powdered milk, it was sad to consume it while the neighborhood kids were being mistreated. It felt to me like a portent of times ahead and the daily injuries of class divisions and humiliations that are spreading in Cuba, even as exciting opportunities arise for those in a position to benefit from them. And another experience that I had just this past December, I was traveling with a group of Americans on a Jewish study trip to the island, visiting Jewish sites, and more frequently now in this past couple of years, I've been traveling with groups, and I've become something else now, a guide, a host in the island that was once my home. And so we were going to dinner at one of the new one of the older private restaurants that I'd never been to, and I'd heard it was known for fine Cuban food. We stepped off the bus. It was a moonless night. I was leading the way forward, leading some elderly people who were on the trip with me, and a voice called out to me, Ruti, my childhood name, and I turned and saw Caro's granddaughter, Amanda, and I was totally confused. What was she doing there? And then I realized that I was in her neighborhood, and I hadn't known that this restaurant that we were going to was just down the street from Caro's house, where I'd spent lots and lots of time. I'd always gone directly to see Caro and hadn't ever looked around and noticed that restaurant. So back in the 90s, when Amanda, her grandchild, was a child, she had accompanied me to one of the first Havana grocery stores for foreigners. And I remember it was a July morning, and she asked me to buy her an apple, which is a very rare treat in Cuba. And I said to her, you should eat mangoes. They're in season. They're much more delicious than apples. They were selling the apples at very ludicrously overpriced, and they were badly bruised, and I didn't want to buy them for her. But later, I got back to Michigan, and I regretted not buying the apples. It was autumn, and I wanted mangoes. And so I wrote a poem back then called Apples. I regret many things, but none so much as the time I refused to buy the 5 red apples for little Amanda in Cuba. The apples were very expensive, it is true. Terribly expensive, even though they had a few bruises. They were for sale in dollars, and only I could buy them for her. I thought, why does she want apples when it is the mango season, and everywhere there are plump, juicy, big, yellow mangoes falling from the trees? But she wanted apples, the ordinary fruit of cold northern lands, and I would not buy them for her. Now it is autumn here, and apples are everywhere, but I long for mangoes. How sour are the apples that would have made little Amanda so happy. And later I gave that poem to Amanda and to Caro. And anyway, so it was a very sad moment because I was with this group and I wanted to go say hello to Caro, but I had to take care of the people that I was leading. And that was one of the moments when I realized, and I didn't get to develop the idea as much as I would have liked to, so thank you for listening to my talk today, but that was when I realized that I was moving into Cubas. There was the half of me that was moving around in the bubble of the air-conditioned Havana tour bus, taking Americans to visit successful artists in their home galleries, peeking into the windows of the mansion on the hill that had belonged to Hemingway, walking through impeccably restored colonial plazas in old Havana. But then there was the half that knew too well how difficult everyday life was for Cubans who barely make do with the food rations offered through the rationing system, through the libreta. And that night, I found the food very tasteless at the restaurant. They were serving these enormous lobsters that I don't eat. And the restaurant was resting on its laurels, merely efficient at serving large groups. But I kept thinking that for Caro and her family, they would have been shocked at the quantities of food and seeing so much of it go to waste. And so at the end of the week, I finally had time to go visit Caro. And before going over, I was at the hotel and I rushed to grab breakfast at the hotel. And there were these musicians, these trio of violinists playing beautiful music. Nobody was listening to them. And I noticed for the first time a bowl of apples at the buffet. There was an outrageous amount of food, eggs, smoked salmon, sausages, yogurt, croissants, donuts, churros, cheeses, even a jar of peanut butter. But I hadn't seen the apples, and so I grabbed the largest apple I could find and brought it to Caro, and she was thrilled. Una manzana, she exclaimed. How precious, that apple from across the border, across the sea. She immediately stashed it in the bottom of the bag with the other things I had brought her. She couldn't leave it out in plain sight, or it would be devoured by whoever found it first. And I knew what she would do. She would save that apple and divide it up at dinner time so her two children, her two grandchildren, one great-grandchild, a cousin who lived next door, and she herself would have an equal piece for dessert. Had I been there last night, she would have given me a slice too. But it was my last night in Cuba, and I was with my group of Americans taking a ride around Havana in a fleet of restored Chevys. In the morning, I would be leaving again, and Caro, now 90, too fragile to come with me to the airport, would not be there to wave goodbye to me. Telling this story, I realize I still don't know how to explain my feelings during this Cuban moment. As someone who's worked for 25 years to build bridges between Cuba and the U.S., I ought to be unequivocally pleased about the restoration of relations between the two countries. And of course, I am pleased, but I'd be lying if I didn't say I feel a little sad, a little uncertain, a little lost in the midst of the fanfare around Cuba. The anthropologist in me cringes at the exotic and distorted image of Cuba circulating in the media. The Cuban American thinks it's all over. My efforts to create bridges, to reach out to fellow writers and artists. The real Americans are coming now with money, power, promises of fame and fortune that I cannot make come true. The poet in me is aching for more depth, more heart, a deeper level of emotion that seems to be missing in the frenzied effort to engage with Cuba before it supposedly changes and loses its distinctiveness, becoming just another franchise for Starbucks, McDonald's, The Gap, and Home Depot. But as I mentioned, projects like this, actually, I also have it up here in a slide. Also, this 99% Cuban design. And here's Idania, who's behind this. And so it's a fascinating idea. It's like this hopeful, futuristic exclamation, you know, actually, I'm in Havana, which is the kind of thing you can do when your internet works and nobody knows exactly where you are. So Cuba belongs to the world because Cuba attempted something huge, to be independent and proud, a small island that demanded to be taken seriously. It is the place with the most long-lived revolutionary fervor in the Americas, despite the embargo, despite the consumer culture that defines our contemporary modern life. This is what makes Cuba, Cuba. To have attempted the impossible and failed so beautifully, everyone wants to lay a flower at the grave of the island's lost dreams. As an anthropologist, a Cuban American, and a poet now nearing 60, I recognize picture of her there, that I may soon reach the age when I can no longer be part of the future of Cuba. As my friend Joe Greer, Cuban-American doctor in Miami, put it, actually just today, talked to me on the phone, he said, should I get on the merry-go-round or not? I'm getting pretty old. I have feared this for a long time, that I will become irrelevant to Cuba even after so many years of dedication and gratitude to this island that gave my Jewish family safe harbor. And in this way, it became my destiny to be born in the other America, not this America, and for me to think of home as being among Latin Americans and Latinas and Latinos, and for the Spanish language to be the language of my heart. I've come to call myself una niña vieja, an old little girl, because I left as a child, and in many ways I'm still a child when I return to Cuba. They view me in Cuba as someone who was taken out of the country. A ella la sacaron, is what they say of me. I wasn't someone who made the decision to leave. I'm granted an innocence that will always be part of my identity on the island. My parents, as I said, have not returned, and I don't know if they ever will. I dream of going with them to Cuba one day, though this fantasy also in some ways frightens me. And I have a long poem, Broken Streets of My City, Las Calles Rotas de Mi Ciudad, illustrated and designed in a handmade book by Rolando Esteves. And I write about the literal broken streets of Havana, my birthplace. Walking on one of those streets, just a couple of years ago, I fell and nearly broke an elbow and was in pain for 3 months, unable to write with my right hand as it healed. The poem also tries to evoke a larger sense of things broken in Cuba, so many things that need to be fixed. And I mourn the dead in the Jewish cemeteries whose graves are broken. They are abandoned spirits whose descendants left Cuba no longer have anyone to visit them. Throughout this poetic journey, I dream of a day when my parents, see them here when they were young, who have never gone back to Cuba, will go with me again. We will walk together through broken streets that will be flooded by the ocean waters. Actually, I have some of the poem here. Let me read that instead. I come back, an old child. Now they call me Señora. I still come back after so many years, an old little girl, una niña vieja. Mommy, papi, please come back. Walk these broken streets of our Habana together with me. Listen to me, your niña vieja. Let me lead you through these broken streets. Utter your bitter complaints. I will listen, I promise. Weep, lament, growl, walk with me. The rain will come as it is coming now. I will kneel, remove your shoes, then remove my own. The ocean will tear down the walls of the Malecón, and we will walk barefoot in the rain. So much water, we will float. Carry us carefully, I will ask. Thank you. Anybody have any questions?
Well, thanks. That was a great talk. How does it feel to be a genius?
I don't know. I'm really not one. I'm, you know, I'm still that little girl in Cuba. And, you know, in my world, I'm still extremely humble and an immigrant girl. So that was just such a lucky break for me that I got that award and really, really changed my life. So just very, very grateful. It's like winning an academic lottery. So I think I was just lucky.
Well, you deserve it. I have another question. It seems like what you mentioned that you mentioned the real Americans are going to come with the Starbucks and everything, and that seems to be the exact kind of system that the whole revolution, Fidel, and the whole revolution built up. And so it seems, as an outsider, it seems kind of funny or strange that they would, the Cuban government would all of a sudden just give that up and say, oh, why don't you come in all that last 50 years of revolutionary talk? Well, you know, sorry, didn't really mean it. So it just seems a dichotomy, and wanted to see what you thought about that.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I mean, we really don't know what's going to happen. I mean, there's so many investors going to Cuba on a daily basis, and Airbnb is already there. And you know, there were 800 people in Obama's delegation to Cuba, 800 people. And I mean, it was amazing. I was there that week, and people got pushed out. People had reservations at hotels, and they got pushed out so that Obama's people could have the hotels, you know, the good hotels in the center of the city. And so 800 people were with him, and there were many, many business people and CEOs of companies, Google, and, you know, everybody wants a piece of Cuba right now. And and it's not clear whether, you know, I mean, I think a lot of people think Starbucks and everything is on the way, and it's all going to be there. They're not going to be able to resist. And that's a possible scenario. But at the same time, I think you're right. I mean, I think that there's a tremendous independent spirit in Cuba. And I don't think they fought a revolution and maintained a revolution for nothing. I mean, I agree with you. I think that it would be really sad to sort of give up everything that they had hoped to achieve. And I say this as a child of exiles, and I was taken out of that system and, you know, didn't get to grow up there, but I still feel very sympathetic for, you know, for the utopian hopes and dreams that Cuba had, and for the sense of pride and autonomy, you know, that they have shown with so much pressure, you know, constantly coming from the U.S. through the embargo, and not to mention all the assassination attempts on Fidel Castro, of which there were, you know, hundreds, you know, including exploding cigars, you know. So they tried everything, but, you know, but they remained. And I think that's one of the things that is, you know, so fascinating about Cuba. You know, they remain there without the United States. And you know, now will all these things that they tried to keep at bay, is it all going to come back to Cuba? It's very, very hard to say. I mean, I think they don't want to lose, the government doesn't want to lose control. And I think the Cuban people don't want to lose control either of, you know, of the good things that they were able to attain during, you know, during all these decades. They've been very, very successful at historic preservation, and you know, Havana has been, you know, really preserved, and architects say it's preservation by neglect, because they weren't actually trying to preserve all these buildings in Havana, but essentially they didn't build a lot of new buildings you know, in Havana, in the center of Havana. And so that's why, you know, there's so many, you know, incredible buildings and architecture preserved in Cuba. And I think things like that, they don't want to lose. They've worked really hard, and preservation has become a really important issue in Cuba. They're also very concerned about their coral reefs. I don't know if you saw an article, if you look it up in the New York Times, there was a great article about Cuba's coral reefs and their oceans, and they have been able to maintain actually very clean oceans and you know, tremendously beautiful coral reefs that haven't been spoiled because there hasn't been the construction of all those hotels on the coast that we see in, you know, in so many other parts of the world. So I think that there's tremendous awareness in Cuba. At the same time, their economy really needs a major boost. And one of the reasons that they've turned to the United States is because they had Chavez, and they had all the support from Venezuela. And when that started to dry up, they had to look elsewhere. But also, you know, I think Raul Castro is a very different kind of ruler from Fidel. And, you know, he didn't seem to feel that having the United States back in Cuba would be a threat to Cuba in the way that Fidel Castro had conceived it. So we're also seeing a very different way of governing the country now. So in short, and, you know, answer to your question, we really don't know what's going to happen, whether all of that is going to come back. I think a lot of people would like to have a Home Depot because, you know, a lot of houses do need to be, fixed up on the island. So it'll be interesting to see indeed if, you know, if this happens. I think right now they're counting on support from Cuban Americans, and the remittances of Cuban Americans are really helping to move the economy forward in Cuba. Many Cuban Americans are also engaging in businesses with friends and family on the island. So that's kind of, you know, the first phase of it, and then carefully letting some American companies in as well. So I think they're trying to go, you know, a phase at a time. And it'll be interesting to see if, in fact, the Carnival cruise, you know, trip happens, if that begins to be, you know, another way that the United States enters Cuba. And there's been a lot of debate since Obama's visit. When I was there, I just talked to people on the street, and people in general really love Obama. They really love him as a president, as a person. He even did, you can see it on YouTube, he even did this comedy sketch with Panfilo. I had meant to show it, but didn't have enough time to do everything, but look it up. I mean, he did two comedy sketches with Panfilo, and it was really amazing. So people really like him in general and appreciate him, but at the same time, many of the official critics of the government, literally as soon as he was done with his speech, began to offer all of these critiques, and is this really just a Trojan horse? He's a very, charming person, but in the end, is it just imperialism coming back again, through him? So there's a lot of debate, and I think that's going to go on, and I think they're going to try to be careful and kind of slowly, let these American businesses do business in Cuba because they need it from an economic perspective. Any more questions? Yeah, right here. Yeah, no, go ahead.
I was just wondering if your friend, the artist, ever reconciled with his family.
Oh, yeah, Rolando Esteves. He pretty much did reconcile. So the sad thing is, so his parents left and they went back to Cuba right like around that time that I first went back in 1979. So they went back, they saw him, and then they wanted to bring him to Miami, but he had been so hurt by being left behind that he didn't want to leave. And then subsequently in the 90s, and I got to know his family pretty well, I was kind of like, I would send messages from him to his family. And sadly, his father became very ill and died, and he wasn't able to get to Miami in time to be there. Then subsequently, his mother lived till about very recently. She just died a year and a half ago. And he began to have opportunities to travel to Miami and spend time with his mother. But I got to know her, and she was definitely a very complicated person, and wasn't always able to give him the love that he needed, even when he went to see her. So it was a complicated relationship, and she would often, I noticed this too, criticize him, even though he was making this effort to see her, and she would call him a communist. And anyway, so it was a complicated relationship, but he did have some good moments with her as well. He was there for a Mother's Day with her before her death and had some good moments. And the really positive thing is his sister is really his sister now. She's never been back to Cuba, so she never wanted to go back. So it took a long time for them to see each other again, but they did. When I invited Esteves to Michigan in the late 90s, and that was the first time that he traveled to Miami and then to Michigan and got to, meet his sister, basically, who he'd last seen when she was 8 years old, So that was an incredible meeting. And his story is just, such a tragic one in many ways, but very common. And that was one of the things that we wanted to do on our blog, Richard and I, was to, create a space for these stories, because there's so many stories like this, among Cubans, these separations that were so intense and heartbreaking, and then people trying to find ways to come together again and reconcile. So I think ultimately he did. Unfortunately, he has art, and through these beautiful handmade books that he produces and the poems that he writes, he's able to find a way to articulate a lot of what that loss meant to him. And I think that I was almost like a returning sister in a sense when I appeared on the scene, similar age to his sister, and kind of arriving sort of out of nowhere from his perspective, and looking looking for a brother in a sense in Cuba. And I think that was a very important part of what brought the two of us together. Thank you for the question. Was there another question?
Yeah, I have one. I wanted to start with thank you because I really, really loved it. But my question is kind of, we talked a lot about the people who left right away, people your parents' age or my grandparents' age, and people your age very young when they left Cuba immediately after the revolution, and then also the people who stayed for the entire time. But what about the people in between, the people who kind of grew up and then left?
Right,
My dad is one of those, and I feel like a lot of those stories don't get told, and I don't get to hear many of his, so I was kind of curious about how much of those you have heard.
Yeah, no, I have heard those stories too, and some of them are on our blog. Carlos Pintado wrote recently for our blog, and he left like in the 90s. So definitely those are stories that are very, very important, and that's a group that's very different from that group of the historic exiles, because they go back and forth to Cuba. Many of them do, much more so, and don't have that sort of grudge against Cuba that, say, many people of my parents' generation have. So I think that they're a very interesting bridge, in fact, because they don't break with Cuba, many people of that wave of migration, and they keep going, you know, back and bringing sort of Cuba, you know, back to the United States and bringing the U.S. to Cuba. And I think actually there's this, you know, I don't know if your father went to Miami or elsewhere. Eventually, yeah, so that kind of seems to be where a lot of Cubans end up one way or another. So there's also kind of this almost Miamiization going on of Cuba, or more exactly a Hialeahization of Cuba going on, because so many Cubans who live in Hialeah, factory workers and just like regular working people who save up and then go to Cuba, bring stuff for their families and so on. Many of them, you know, go and you can kind of see like they've shopped at Target or they've shopped at Macy's, and those clothes that end up, you know, people in Cuba end up wearing those. And so there's this interesting back and forth, you know, that's happening. And I think you're right. I think that's, you know, those are stories that really need to be told more. I hope you'll find a way to tell them. That would be great. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
This is a little maybe out of scope and tone and topic, but what do you think of when U.S. politicians whose typically wealthier parents or grandparents left Cuba, which influences conservative political careers, claim an understanding of the immigrant and refugee experiences discussed in today's elections?
Might need to hear that question again. It sounds okay. Really good. I just want to be sure I got
okay.
it all.
How do you feel when U.S. politicians whose parents or grandparents left Cuba claim an understanding of immigrant and refugee experiences discussed in today's elections?
Are you speaking about some politicians that I think I know who they are? I'm not sure what to say. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of hypocrisy among certain politicians, yes, absolutely, who didn't experience things perhaps firsthand, or experienced perhaps part of it, maybe the experience of being a child of immigrants, but not necessarily the experience of fleeing, you know, revolutionary Cuba. I'm not sure if that's what you're referring to. So, yeah, so I'm sorry, I don't think I have a good answer for you. I'm going to have to. Can somebody else help me with that? Yeah, thank you. Please
all
help me.
All I would say, in addition, is the Cuban American immigration experience, regardless of how they got here, tends to be very different from most other, in particular, Latin American immigrants. But all immigrants, they have this very unique way to get here that makes it very difficult.
Oh, yeah. It makes it very difficult to talk about my parents being an immigrant and to talk about this to Mexican Americans, that it's a very different story. And I'll let you talk further.
Thank you. That's exactly the help I was needing. Yeah. I think that's a good point. I mean, every immigrant story has its unique situation, unique elements. And, you know, the Cuban story is a story of different vintages and different waves of migration. I spent time with the historic exiles because they were the ones that kind of created, in a sense, the imaginary homeland. It kind of started, you know, with them, and then others had to find a way to either be part of that or not part of that. But I think the Cuban story is different from other immigrant journeys from Latin America and the Caribbean, because in the initial phases, we could not go back. So in part because of the embargo and in part because the passports were stamped, you know, definitive departure, you could not go back. And so that led to the need to create, you know, this very strong notion of an imaginary homeland, because there wasn't a homeland to go back to, right? So the door was closed to return. And I think that was a different situation from other immigrants who could theoretically go back to their home countries, assuming they had enough money to do so, assuming that they were able to, you know, legalize their status in this country to then be able to travel back. But essentially those places were still there to go back to in theory, whereas in the Cuban case, up until recently, now there's all this back and forth and mobility that we didn't have before. But up through the 90s, it was very, very difficult to go back to Cuba. And so, you know, there was the sense that the island, in a sense, had to be recreated mythically because you couldn't, you know, you couldn't go back to it. So I think that you know, created a certain kind of Cuban sensibility that I think is different from some of the other Latino sensibilities in this country.
We have time for one more question.
Okay.
Hi, thank you for such a beautiful presentation. As a Tibetan exile, I could relate to a lot of the things that you talked about as far as displacement. Thank you. Sorry. I was hoping you could talk about recreating homeland, especially about, you talk about your parents' reluctancy to go back, mm-hmm. which is something I think a lot of exiles actually face. Mm-hmm. I was wondering if you could talk more about that in terms of, I noticed that it's not just a generational thing, even within, there's just the fear that you just talked about, mm-hmm. not being able to see what they've been trying to recreate. Like what about that fear? Mm-hmm. I was hoping to hear more about that.
Yeah, no, thank you. Thanks for sharing that with me. Yeah, and with everybody here today. Yeah, you know, it's really complex. You know, I think my mother has such a strong desire to return to Cuba and before she dies. Now she's saying, now that she's in her 80s, she's saying, I want to go to Cuba before I die. So that makes it very emotional. But my father, you know, what's good about my father is, well, one of his favorite expressions in English that he learned early on my parents still mainly speak Spanish to one another, but one of the first expressions he learned in English, I think this is so interesting, is case closed. I don't know if that comes from a TV program, probably like Judge Judy, I don't know, something, but case closed. That's one of his favorite expressions, case closed. So he does, there's things he doesn't want to talk about, he doesn't want to complicate his life. He doesn't like the idea of looking back, which I think is actually like a very American concept, actually. It's like we have to look forward, you know, we're building the future. He's always arguing with me about this, like, why are you so interested in the past? You know, like, we have a great life here. Like, just forget Cuba. That's my father's attitude. But, you know, people say one thing and feel and do another. So he says that, but he's up to date on everything that's happening in Cuba. He's the kind of person that, you know, there are Cuban jokes that circulate on the internet, so he's got all the Cuban jokes. And the interesting thing is, and there are people in Cuba that would love to meet my father and hang out with him in Cuba, because when I made my movie, I interviewed my father, because the movie was actually dedicated to my father to see if I could get him to go to Cuba. So the movie was dedicated to him. And he, you know, he's in the film. And the interesting thing is that people on the island found him charming. And I thought, charming? He's such a difficult person. They thought he was charming and that he was very Cuban because of his way of talking, his gestures, his sense of humor. People actually felt a link to him, even though he's the most anti-Castro, anti-revolution person you can imagine, but there's something Cuban about him that people recognize on the island. And there's, I've got a friend who always says to me, ¿Cuándo viene tu papá? You know, every time she sees me, ¿Cuándo viene tu papá? When is your father coming? So it's interesting. And so people are contradictory because he has this like strong, like case closed attitude towards Cuba. But on the other hand, he's up on everything. And what's interesting is that certain things haven't changed. since we left. And so, for example, the bus routes are all the same in Old Havana and with the same bus numbers. So he would know what bus to get on, you know, to move around Old Havana. So in this weird way, you know, it really is the imaginary homeland, and it's like the island is in his head, and it's very real for him, even though he claims not to care. And I think that's a coping mechanism, you know, this denial, like, no, I don't want to go back, you know, and so on. But I think he really does, but doesn't want to admit it. But I think the emotional part is very deep too, and I think particularly as people get older, it's the sense of they were young in Cuba. You know, when we left, my parents were in their mid-20s, you know, back at a time people married young. My brother and I were born, you know, when my parents were like 20 and 22 years old. So, you know, so it was just, you know, they were a very young married couple, and they left in their mid-20s. So all the pictures of them in Cuba, they're beautiful and young, and now they would go back, they'd be old, and they have changed, Cuba has changed, and there's this kind of fear, that's where the fear comes in, about, you know, finding themselves in maybe a Cuba that isn't the Cuba, you know, of their dreams, the Cuba that they've held on to, you know, for 50 plus years. And so that's where the fear comes in. But I try to assure them that, in fact, if they went, they would feel very at home. And my parents joke about this, and now that they're both retired, they spend their nights like watching Spanish TV. They watch the news in Spanish now. They watch telenovelas, and they said like they're forgetting their English. So they would feel totally at home in Cuba, language-wise and culture and so many other ways. And so they're the ones that should go, and that's one of the ironies I think about all of my trips, is they are the ones who should go, not me. I don't remember Cuba. I've had to reconstruct Cuba through all these trips and making friends, and through Caro and, you know, Cristi and all, you know, all these people that have, you know, created a homecoming for me. I've had to construct that. My parents could just automatically go, and they would, you know, they would fit right in. They would know what to do in many ways. And so the irony that I go, in a sense, for them, and really wish that they would go. But I still have a lot of hope that, you know, that maybe they will go. And in fact, it was my mother. I had just come back from Cuba from being there for Obama's visit. And as soon as I got back, my mother already knew, you know, knew the news about the Carnival cruise thing. And she said something really funny, the way she put it. Oh yeah, this is happening, pero no para nosotros. You know, and I thought, oh, you know, it's like we're being left out of this party. It's like the Carnival cruise is, my parents actually do like cruises, you know. And it's like, you know, it's like the Carnival cruise is going, pero no, 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 para nosotros no. And I had this like sense of sadness from her that, you know, of the sense of exclusion, like, no, we don't get to go back yet, you know. So I think it's deep, and I hope that, you know, that that they don't delay too long, you know, and that we can go. I think it would be really amazing. My brother hasn't gone back either, which is also interesting, because obviously we grew up in the same household, and I'm 3 years older than my brother. My brother's a jazz musician in Philadelphia, and the thing about my brother is he doesn't like to travel. So for my brother, it's more, this is going to be very, like, big hassle, you know. I've got to fly to Miami, and then I've got to fly to Cuba, and then I've got to get the special visa and paperwork. No. So my brother is, as my mother says, muy cómodo. You know, he's like very comfortable about things. You know, he doesn't want to like trouble himself with all this. So he's not been back either. And so my hope is maybe at some point, you know, get them all to go back. But I would have to make everything extremely comfortable for my brother and like make it super easy for him to go. So I hope that happens. And I think especially as a musician, you know, and I think we each carry Cuba in a different way. I mean, I carry Cuba by having become an anthropologist and traveling, and I'm very nomadic in spirit and always kind of moving around. And for me, like, I live from traveling in a sense. And my brother's completely the opposite. You know, he's in Philadelphia, plays his piano every day. You know, and playing a piano is like a big deal because we weren't allowed to learn the piano when we were growing up because my mother said that, you know, we might have to leave. You know, maybe we'd have to leave the United States someday. And so the piano was not an instrument for refugees. So, you know, so we were encouraged to play the violin or the guitar or the accordion, you know, portable instruments. And so the fact that my brother, you know, is you know, plays the piano every day. There's a sense of settledness, and I think that's so important to him. But I feel that it's through music, you know, music being so much at the heart of Cuban life, that that's where his Cuba is, and mine is more in going back and being there and traveling, but, you know, but that we each kind of have a different way of anchoring ourselves, you know, in our Cuban identity. So I hope that answers a little bit.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lara.